This Dr. Sangwan is our star speaker, and he is the face of modern stem cell biology from India. So he will be talking on this long-term outcome of SLATE and then bilateral visual, unilateral cases, how to visually rehabilitate these patients.
Thank you very much, Tohin, and good morning. A brief talk about unilateral limbal stem cell deficiency. How do you manage? This gentleman is a 28-year-old who lives in London, but is from Gujarat, had LASIK done. And one of the eye, after he went back to London, had a fulminant fungal infection. The flap was removed, and the fungal antifungal treatment was started. Then he was told that the prognosis is not very good. So therefore, he got very scared. He came back to Ahmedabad, and there also the doctors were not very sure that this eye can be salvaged. So he reported to L.V. Prasad Eye Institute in 2006, just a few weeks later. And then what we did, a very large therapeutic graft, removing all the infected tissue, and waited for 9 months. After that, we took the limbal biopsy from the normal eye, grew it on the piece of amniotic membrane in the lab. It's called cultivated limbal epithelial transplantation, or CLAT, and he underwent that procedure. And following that, the cornea was scarred, and therefore he underwent a penetrating keratoplasty with ECCIOL, and that restored around 20/50 vision, which till around 4-5 year follow-up that I had been following him, did very well. After that, he was lost to follow-up. So when you have chemical burns and some other conditions which cause chronic damage to the ocular surface, and the videos what you are seeing, these are the varying degrees of a condition called limbal stem cell deficiency. And this limbal stem cell deficiency is characterized by growing of the, or ingrowth of the conjunctiva with fibrovascular pannus on the corneal surface. And this leads to reduction in vision and all the symptoms associated with the limbal stem cell deficiency. So only treatment for established limbal stem cell deficiency is some sort of limbal transplantation. It can be conjunctival limbal autograft, a direct one. It can be a cultivated limbal epithelial transplant, or a SLET, simple limbal epithelial transplantation. So I'll give briefly about these, talk about these techniques. So this is the technique that we developed in LVP from 2001 onwards, where you grow these cells on, you take the limbal biopsy from the normal eye of the patient. So it is an autologous procedure. You don't need systemic immunosuppression. And then grow the cells in the lab on a piece of amniotic membrane. It takes about 2 weeks. And then you bring an replication in the peer-reviewed literature, and had a success rate of in the range of 75% to 78%. The problem with this technique was that it can be done only in places where you have an expensive stem cell lab. And to maintain that lab is very expensive. Then the patient has to come 2 times, once for biopsy and then for second surgery. And third, the regulatory constraints. Regulation-wise, it's very difficult to obtain the permission to do such kind of surgeries. You can, but it takes much time and it's more expensive. Also, in pediatric patients, the limbal stem cell deficiency, the CLAT outcome was very poor. So we started thinking and of innovating it further, how we can address this problem. So what we came up with was simple limbal epithelial transplantation. And this is the first paper that we reported in 2012 in British Journal of Ophthalmology, where you are seeing the biopsy being taken. Now, instead of sending to the lab, what we do, we clean up the pannus and then cut that pannus into pieces, stick the membrane, what Tohin was showing, in exactly the similar way after cleaning the corneal surface. And then you explant those pieces on the surface of the amniotic membrane and fix them with the fibrin glue. Wait for a minute or so, and then once the glue is polymerized, you use the bandage contact lens. In certain situations, you may have to do simulacron release with conjunctival autograft if it is necessary. You may or may not need tarsorrhaphy, depending on the situation. And otherwise, the rest of the surgery, as you can see in this video clip, is fairly straightforward once you have seen and you have learned. So now, the technique, what you are seeing, this video clip is very old, maybe 2012, 2013. Now what we do is, the explants, you put explants first, and then put the fibrin glue, not the other way around. Why? Because you put the fibrin glue, it polymerizes, and it's become very sticky. And when you have putting the explants, it's very difficult to rearrange them. So put the explants, then put a little bit of drop of the fibrin glue on each of the explants, and then a bandage contact lens. The surgical technique, I will skip this video because I have already shown you, but in brief, it can deal with very extensive kind of penis like what you are seeing here, and cleaning procedure or dissection involves selectively removing the penis and not doing a keratectomy. So finding the plane of insertion of the penis into the cornea is very important, and that plane you can find only if you remain peripheral or go from limbus to central cornea. Beyond limbus you start dissecting, where you the plane is very clear because you can see the sclera, you can feel it, and then go centrally, and after that you do limited cautery and put the amniotic membrane, iron it out and trim the excess membrane, and then put the explant, and then put a BCL. These are some of the examples before and after surgery. This gentleman had acute chemical burn which healed with the amniotic membrane but had a granuloma. This is a 3-year follow-up of patients who underwent SLET, and now we have fairly long follow-up of 5 years, 7 years in some patients. There is another unique observation we noted in these patients, that like this patient underwent a SLET in August of 2011, and corneal scarring was quite a bit. Vision did not improve immediately, but we waited for some time. At this stage, we thought it's pretty good. Patient wanted better vision, but he didn't want to have surgery. So we offered him PK or DALK, and also tried contact lenses, but patient was not very keen for anything. So he just came, we called him every year. So this is what happens, that over a period of time, in SLET patients, you do see the clearing of the corneal stroma, and that is because the mesenchymal cells in the corneal, in these explants, are continuing to work. And there is a very good science why this happens, what that happens. There is a something called HGF, hepatocyte growth factor, which is secreted by the mesenchymal cells and which clears the corneal stroma, corneal stromal scarring. So now you can wait for a longer time if there is no urgency, and there is a very high chance that cornea will clear. My rate of doing corneal transplant or DALK following limbal transplantation has gone down significantly after SLET. In the CLET, I would roughly about 20-25% of patients would undergo PK or CLET or DALK. With SLET, that had gone down dramatically down. Another application of SLET is in patients who have extensive OSSN, especially if it is more than 2 clock hours and you do excision and do the standard technique of removal, then you will definitely get a stem cell deficiency. And if you do a secondary limbal transplantation, the chance of success is very poor. And I had that experience of treating those patients with CLAT, but the outcome was poor. So now what we do is, we recommend that you combine the excision with SLET at the same time. And there is an excellent evidence published from LVP by Dr. Swati Kalki, and a small case series from Dr. Vikas Mittal. Another unique application of SLET is in pediatric LSCD. We did, this was a case series published by Vikas Mittal of SLET in patients with the pediatric LSCD. And then this is a patient done in LVP in GMRV, YJAC, and it turned out excellent. Then when we analyze our patients and publish in the journal Ophthalmology, we had about 50% of the pediatric patients in this series and 50% were adult. And if you look at the outcome in success rate in pediatric and adult LSCD are very similar. And so we feel that this technique has really changed the management of limbal stem cell deficiency in a different many ways. Then some of these patients underwent PK or DALK, in which we did the immunofluorescence to establish at the molecular level whether we reconstituted the corneal surface, corneal phenotype or not. And this is shown here very nicely that that is the case, that there is a reconstitution of the corneal surface. These are some further markers. Then there is a study by a group of doctors from India and from this US and Mexico. They've shown, they pulled their cases of SLET and reported their outcome, which seems to be exactly the experience what we had. What it shows is that our series from LVP was a single center, but this is a multi-center. Doctors learned by themselves and reported the outcome. So this technique seems that it is not that difficult to teach or learn. Then there are further replication and innovations by different surgeons around the world. These are further modifications of some people call top-up SLET, some called minor SLET or mini SLET for variety of indication, or a double layer or a sandwich technique. And this is the comparison of these three techniques which I talked about, CLAW, CLAT, and SLET. So if you look at the numbers and the success rate, the highest number of cases are in CLAT and SLET, and SLET has the SLET and CLAT have exactly similar outcome, even SLET is better. So what is the downside with CLAW is that you need a large amount of tissue. With CLAT you need small tissue, but you need a lab and you need twice surgery. So the SLET addresses the downside of both the techniques and combines the positives, and hence offers a much better alternative. How does SLET re-epithelize the corneal surface? This is a paper by Vikas Mittal, published in Cornea in 2015, that what he did is, in this patient, started staining every other day, take off the Bender's contact lens, and as the time passes, you can see the clearing of the area or epithelization around the explants, and each explant, there is a circumferential growth, then all those circumferential circles meet, and you get a monolayer, and that in due course of time becomes stratified. And this is the exact similar mechanism that we observed in our CLAT patients in the laboratory, which is shown here. Then also we did a high definition AIOC2020 showing the expansion of cells from each explant over a period of time. This is day one, this is day five, and you can see the smoothening and thinning of the explants as the cells spread out. And by day 11 you get 11 to 14 days you get a monolayer, and in about 6 weeks you get a stratified epithelium, and in 6 months, after 6 months, generally if it is very good outcome, you may not be able to differentiate whether this patient has undergone a surgery or not. Also we have worked on certain ideas, how many explants do you need, how thick they should be. We worked out that even if you put a single explant in the center, that will re-epithelize the corneal surface, but the quality of the mesenchymal cells and the epithelium may not be as good. So therefore, having at least 10 to 12 explants is what we recommend in a total limbal stem cell deficiency. Then we have been working on ideas about establish a rabbit model of SLET to understand the biology, and I have replicating this model now in Delhi in Dabur Research Foundation. So in summary, there is the SLET is very effective, replicable, repeatable, affordable, and a reliable technology, which is open platform, and surgeons are free to innovate for their situations and their clinical application. Thank you very much.